this crucial relation between spinners and vectors that, you know, spinners in some sense are a square root of vectors. They're mathematical objects that if you take the product, the tensor product of these of two of them, you get a vector. And if you think of vectors as being corresponding to translations, we know that the world has this world is locally looks like a certain vector space of four dimensions, and you can translate in any four directions, and you get corresponding momentum or energy operators. And then there's also rotations. But what supersymmetry says is, well, you should extend your standard story about momentum and angular momentum and how it fits together into this Poincaré-Lie algebra, and you get these generators. You should add some new generators which correspond to the spinner direction, which correspond to the spinners. And they're going to be anti-commuting, unlike the ones you know about. And they're anti-commutator. The fact that the tensor product of two spinners is a vector will correspond to the fact that the anti-commutator of two of these operators will be a translation operator. So that's the basic idea of supersymmetry. It is a beautiful idea, and so what you do then is you what people did starting in 1974 was you take the standard model, and you just kind of add some fields to it and things which then allow you to define this extended symmetry and define these new spinner generators, these Qs, these supersymmetry generators. And you could do that with the standard model. You could also play the same game with one of these grand unified theories. You could take your favorite grand unified theory and turn it into a supersymmetric grand unified theory. Okay, and again, so there's a lot of enthusiasm about this. I mean, a lot of it was also kind of driven by just the beauty of the idea. This is a really beautiful idea. If you try and do this, you find that these Qs commute with all of the this U1 cross. This U1, SU2, SU3 commutes with these Qs. So you find what a Q is going to do is it's going to take any particle that you know about with certain charges, and it's going to turn it into a super partner. It's going to produce a different kind of particle which has exactly all of the same standard model charges, but it has spin differing by a half.
Mm-hmm.
because it has a spinner nature. So it has this prediction that, okay, well, and maybe I shouldn't say that completely. This wasn't completely enthusiasm. What you would have really liked to have happened was to look at the list of particles that you know about the standard model and find two of them that are related by one of these supersymmetry generators. If you had two particles that differed by spin,
yes,
by spin half, and that had the same standard model charges, that would be a good candidate.
You would identify them as super partners.
Yeah, those you'd have two super partners and. Anyway, and in some sense, that I think the problem is you don't see this. So you've had this beautiful new symmetry, but the problem is it doesn't relate any two known things. It relates everything you know to something you've never seen before.
I see.
So technically, this symmetry acts trivially on everything you know about. but you can then say, okay, well, this gives us a prediction of. You know, we've only seen half the particles in the world. That there's every particle we know about is going to have a super partner. That's kind of what you say. And some people, I guess, would take this enthusiastically. Oh, great! You know, there's all these new particles in the world. I think I and many people were also a little bit. Wait a minute. This is a little bit implausible that this doesn't. There's this new symmetry, but we haven't kind of seen any of its effects. But anyway, so then this is the supersymmetry. There's a long story, but it goes into the LHC is now given, you know, has very, very strong limits on this. There really are no super partners, and there's just zero evidence for any of this. Okay, so then you can do another part of the unification paradigm is supergravity and Kaluza-Klein, and again these are things that were developed, you know. A little bit later, but within a few years after the standard model. And supergravity is basically, you turn supersymmetry into a gauge theory, and it gives you an extension of general relativity. The gravitino is a partner to the graviton, and you have a theory which you could hope, uh, you could you, when you quantize it, would have, it seems to have less fewer renormalizability problems. That's a whole long story. But anyway, we had the supergravity theories. And then you also, going way back to early days of general relativity, people had been looking at what happens if you have more than four space-time dimensions. And so can you explain, one thing you might try to do is explain where does U1, SU2, SU3 come from by postulating more than four space-time dimensions, and it's these other so-called, you know, kind of internal dimensions which explain everything. And that had been an idea that was wrong for a long time, but it became kind of a big part of this paradigm that people were looking at.
I have a quick question. So supersymmetry can be formulated at the classical level, correct?
Yeah.
Okay, so if you're putting supersymmetry on GR, then do you have a gravitino? Like, you don't have a graviton at the classical level.
Well, you don't have, so this would be, you'd have a gravitino in the quantum version. But yeah, but you've got...
Like, does the classical version of supersymmetric general relativity have any properties that are wanted or that are studied? Or do people only care about it because it allows something interesting when you quantize it?
Well, the problem is that it's a problem with all supersymmetric theories. When you, there is a classical version of them, but the problem is that you've extended that your standard kind of variables with these to get fermions, you've extended your standard variables with these anti-commuting variables. So it's kind of a weird, so classically it's kind of a weird subject.
So you have non-commuting classical variables.
Yeah, you have non-commuting classical variables. So you can write down such a theory, you can look at it, but it doesn't kind of correspond to any, I mean, all of our intuitions about what's going on in classical physics, it doesn't really correspond to any of, you've got all these new degrees of freedom, which just have different, which are kind of different weird algebraic things, which aren't what you're used to thinking about.
I see.
So,
now someone like Alain Conis, would he be comfortable with classical non-commutativity? Or does he only study quantum non-commutativity?
Well, he's more interested. I mean, it's non-commutativity, but of a very specific sort. It's what we mathematicians, what is sometimes called Z2 graded commutativity or super commutativity. It's like things don't commute, but the extent to which they don't commute is just something very, very minor, that they pick up, certain things pick up minus signs when you interchange them.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, I think someone like Alain Conis or people, when people are talking about non-commutative geometry, that they're often generally, they generally mean something much more seriously non-commutative, where it's not just, yeah, anyway, this is often, so mathematicians would often call this supercommutative, and it's, and actually, you know, I mean, the people who do kind of standard commutative geometry, you know, they're used to having these little algebraic gadgets in it, which square to zero and which anti-commute. That's also part of their story. It's kind of, so some mathematicians would claim, you know, it's really just part of commutative geometry. It's not what, like the non-commutative geometry that Alain Conis wants. So now this is actually getting into the period when I actually remember. So I was a undergraduate starting in 75, and I was taking quantum field theory courses starting in 76, 77, and starting to try to pay attention to what was going on. And so I remember a lot of that this was kind of what people were talking about as the answer to these unification problems at that time when I first got into this. And like one example was, you know, Hawking gave his kind of initial lecture for his professorship and called, you know, "Is the End in Sight for Theoretical Physics?" And he basically was saying, well, you know, this, we've got this supergravity and this Kaluza-Klein version, and it looks like, you know, looks like it should give us a quantum theory which everything fits into and which is just going to explain everything. But anyway, there's the basic problem that none of this kind of worked out in the sense that, you know, we've never seen any extra dimensions. We've never seen anything besides four dimensions. So there's really never been anything giving an indication that the Kaluza-Klein idea goes somewhere. Well, there's no gravitinos, and maybe that's a little bit unfair because it's hard enough to see gravitons. You're probably not going to see gravitinos either, but there's really kind of nothing. These ideas kind of never led to anything which you could go out and check it anyway. Or if you went out and tried to check it, it wasn't there. So then that was kind of the situation in the early 80s. And then people had been also studying these string theories, and that's a long history we could don't really talk about here. But maybe one interesting thing is that the first superstring theory that the idea that it could describe gravity, that you could describe it, gravity using a superstring, was first paper about that was like a month after the standard model was in place. Anyway, but that kind of exploded in 1984 when Woit got into the subject, and there was a very serious interest in doing unification this way.
If you enjoyed this toe clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. Don't forget to follow Theories of Everything with Kurt Jaimungal on Spotify for exclusive content and in-depth discussions. Your support on Spotify helps us grow and to reach more curious minds like yours. Check out the link in the description and join the Core Toe community on Spotify today. See you there.